are overjoyed today to be speaking with Professor John Mbiti. Professor Mbiti is Emeritus Professor of Theology at the University of Bern in Switzerland, and internationally acclaimed and pioneering scholar of African Christianity, as well as an ordained Anglican priest. Professor Mbiti earned his PhD at the University of Cambridge in 1963 in the Theology of the New Testament. Professor Mbiti is the author of many classic studies, including the renowned African Religions and Philosophy, published in 1969. Today, we will be delighted to be speaking to Professor Mbiti about the second edition of his book, Introduction to African Religion. Professor Mbiti is the recipient of several honorary degrees, including an honorary doctorate from the University of Lausanne in Switzerland, an honorary doctorate from General Theological Seminary in New York City, and also an honorary doctorate from Colgate University in New York. Professor Mbiti is married to Verena. He has 4 children and 5 grandchildren. Dr. Mbiti, we're very honored to be speaking with you today.
Thank you. I feel the same too.
Professor Mbiti, we understand that you're working on a translation from the Greek New Testament into the Kikamba language. Would you be willing to share with us about this exciting translation project?
Well, as a matter of fact, I am not translating. I have done the translation, and the translation has been published. So it is fait accompli. But I can tell you how come I made the translation. There are several new Bible translations into my language, Kikamba, spoken by about 5 million people, of whom about more than 85% are Christians. And the work of the Christian spreading of the gospel started already in the 19th century. The first missionary to Eastern Africa, Dr. Johannes Krapf, came to Ukambani and translated. He was at the coast, at Mombasa. He translated the Gospel of St. Mark into Kikamba. 1850, it was published. It was one of the very, very first translations of the Bible into African languages, in any case, in Eastern Africa. Of course, the Ethiopian and Coptic translations were already there. But in modern Africa, this was one of the very, very first translations. Now, other translations have been done, published in New Testament, 1920, done by missionaries, and a full Bible, 1956. And then newer translations, New Testament, 2002, and then the full Bible, 2011. Now, I compared these translations with the Greek New Testament and saw some deviations, put it that way, some non-conformity. And so I said, well, let me try and see what it means to translate the Bible. So that's why I went to the Greek and not to English or other. And I started with the Gospel of John, the first 5 verses, and I got so fascinated. I said, let me go on and do the chapter. I did, and I got even more fascinated. I said, well, why don't I do the whole book? Okay. And it went on like that. I said, okay, I will plunge and do the whole New Testament. And it took me 8 months of the actual working hours on it. Within a period of 2 years, I worked day and night, exactly day and night, because sometimes I would work till midnight. And the translation would go on in my bed while I lay asleep, just wondering if that was the right word I used and so on. So anyway, within a period of 2 years, working hours of 8 months. And I did all that between other duties. I had to travel quite a lot and give lectures and be with the mother family here in Switzerland and in Kenya, so on. So that's why I just say the working hours, 8 months. And then I tried to ask Bible societies to if they would publish it. Well, I'm sorry, they didn't accept. There is a big story behind all that, but I will not go into that. They couldn't, and I tried secular publishers. They said it is too expensive. We cannot publish it and get back our expenses. So then one publisher in Kenya, Kenya Literature Bureau, it is the oldest publisher in Eastern Africa, African publisher in Eastern Africa, and the biggest in Africa, biggest indigenous publisher in Africa, they accepted to publish it if I would find the money to cover the costs. Okay, I tried various places to ask for fund, churches and Bible societies and firms, organizations, and so on in Europe, in America, in Australia, everywhere I could. But none gave me anything. A friend of mine here in Switzerland, fellow minister, church minister, we talked about it. And he said, I will help you to raise money. So he approached friends, and we wrote then the project. And it at the same time in Kenya, the people who heard about my translation said, this is a book which should be distributed to the schools, to the primary schools, so that they also can read the Bible. You see? So with that appeal for publishing the book for primary schools in Ukambani, we launched the appeal, and the Christians and friends in Switzerland contributed very generously. And a few churches and institutions, and some few people in America also contributed. So the amount reached the point where the book could be printed. And it was then printed in 3,000 copies in the year 2014. And published in December 2014. Now, one very good thing about this publisher is that because it publishes school books. It is the whole country, all the schools where it distributes books. And it then said it will distribute the Bible to the schools because it has the addresses and has the facilities and the contacts and the teachers and so on. So that was very, very great blessing. So it published and started distributing the books. Now, the distribution could go only up to 70 schools because each school had to get several copies in order that a class can read the Bible where two or three children sit at a desk. And then with their teacher, they can then read together. That's why it was only distributed to a limited number. And now we hoped we can get more funds for the next printout to continue the distribution with up to, if possible, the 3,000 primary schools. So that is, I'm sorry, I made it so long because I'm so involved in it.
Professor Mbiti, thank you so much for those introductory comments. In your book, Introduction to African Religion, you explain that African religion, unlike Christianity or Muhammad, has no central founder. Instead, African religion developed over many centuries as part of an African way of life in the African context. In this light, how would you differentiate between African religion and African philosophy?
I would only say that African philosophy is not something official as such. This is an academic designation. And also African religion, there is no word in African languages for religion. And African philosophy is simply a philosophical explanation of some of the religious concepts, purely academic explanation of those religious concepts which people, you know, hold, and trying to set that in people's lives, people's reflection, people's worldview that comes out of the religion. Worldview is a philosophical concept, but you would not find it as such in African thought. There is no philosophy, but religion, also the word is not used. What is used are religious expressions, practical expressions of it, and also discussions, concepts. For example, the concept of God, that is not a concept of God is not, God is not a practical person like praying. Now, prayers, people talk of prayers, they make prayers in African religion. There are also blessings which they give in African religion. There is music, they dance their religion, religious ideas and life and so on. So religion is simply in terms of activities and thoughts, ideas, beliefs. Now, the central belief in African religion is belief in God. That is absolutely central, and it's also very ancient belief. To talk about God, to give you an example, I made a collection of peoples according to their languages and their religious practices of what people say and do to talk about God and how they relate with God. Now, I made a research in the field, so to speak, practical research, as well as academic research in libraries and so on and books. And I put together that information into quite a sizable book, this book, Concepts of God in Africa. And in that book, among other things, what I did was to collect the names, the words, the expressions with which people talk about God. And I have a collection of these names numbering approximately 1,006, just over 1,600 names by which people talk about God. And these names from 600 languages. So this is simply to indicate that people have God in their central concept of their religious life and the ideas. God is central in African religion. So one can, to use academic term, it's monotheistic. African religion is very monotheistic. And interestingly enough, and although I know you may raise that later, interestingly enough is that many of these concepts that are expressed, that I have collected, have overlappings with Old Testament and to a certain extent New Testament concepts of God. This is the most amazing thing I've found. And names of people, for example, Akan people, the names of God in the Akan language, or even my own language, Kikamba. The main name of God is Mulungu. And then there are Mulungu, you cannot write it down, but anyway, I can. And then we have other names. Asa, that means father, mother, parent in Kikamba. So people call God Asa, father, parent. Okay, another name for God is Mombi. Mombi means creator, fashioner, maker, molder, potter. Another name in Kikamba is Mwatwangi, and it means cleaver, the one who splits. That is the one who makes details of everything. Cleaver, distributor, the one who distributes things, everything, distributes the leaves to a tree, distributes grass, distributes the birds and so on, distributor. And then splicer, the one who opens up, splicer. Another one is mwene vinya wonde, and that means the one having all power, the Almighty. Now, these are the names that African people have been using to talk about God. And when they pray, like Akamba, when they pray in the traditional way, they would call God Asa, Father, Mother, Parent, you know, Maker. And then, or they would make a prayer at the birth of a child and kind of lift the child up a bit like this and pray to God and say, Maker, who has given us this child, this fruit, this small thing, bless it, you know. And I've also collected prayers, many prayers. Another of my books is The Prayers of African Religion. These are traditional prayers which people have been saying for centuries, for generations. And again, one is absolutely amazed by the depth of spirituality in these prayers, where they call upon God as our Maker. Like in the times of drought because people depend very much on rain. When there is a drought, very severe drought, they would have a ritual prayer where the community comes together. And they may, in some places, they may sacrifice a sheep of one color. Again, these are some parallels with the Old Testament or the Jewish Bible. And anyway, so they would come and pray and call upon God. One of the main names of God in African languages is Giver of Rain. And so they would call upon God as Giver of Rain. And please bring us rain. They would cry and, plead with God to have rain. And so on. I mean, I cannot give you the whole lot in a short time like this, you know. Mm-hmm. Well, so that is, and that's why religion simply sprung out of people's experiences and people's reflection about the world. For example, they would ask, who made the sun? Who made the earth? Who makes us? Who makes babies in the mother's womb? Where do they come from? You know? And then they would say, Mumbi, the creator. You see? And they would say, well, the sun is, some would even say, the sun is a symbolic eye of God. He watches all over. He is present everywhere. You know? These are symbolic ways of talking about God, and so on. Well, again, this is one of my academic interests in which I've been teaching and writing, and I can go on and on.
Professor Mbiti, that is a fascinating response, and I'm genuinely just fascinated by your studies of African religion. You've noted that there are striking similarities between the biblical concept of God and the biblical names for God and African religions. Did you discover any notable differences between the names and concepts given to God in African religions and that given in the Bible?
Well, I was more fascinated by the similarities. Because differences, I couldn't find any list of differences. I only found list of similarities. Now, naturally, there would be things like in the New Testament, what the message of Jesus is and who Jesus is, that is absolutely not there, at least not in a historical way. I have written published a paper on the presence, the silent presence of Jesus in African religion. And that refers to some of the things that Jesus was teaching, you know, like about the love of God, that you find also in African religion. God loves the people. That's why, in fact, some people say, if God Akamba, I've heard them say, if God didn't love me, he would not have made me. You know, this kind of very simple way of acknowledging things like that. And the creator, where Jesus says, look at the fields and the flowers. Look at the birds, how they don't so they don't reap, but God feeds them. That's exactly the kind of teaching or practice in African religion, which is inbuilt there. So like that, I wrote this paper just to indicate that in some ways, the presence of Jesus was in African religion, but not openly, not expressed by name, but the presence of Jesus seems to be there. And also the way people treat one another. This one of the pictures I put is about the Good Samaritan, because I have put some many photographs into my New Testament, and one of them is a place where tradition says this was the hotel or the place where the Good Samaritan brought the victim to be, anyway, or the places with the sheep being looked after. Now, Akamba, for example, are herders of sheep and goats. These are not foreign things, foreign words. People know them and know the value. When Jesus says, I'm the good shepherd, they know what that means, because we look after sheep. We know the value of sheep. And when Jesus says, I call them by name and they follow me, That is exactly what we have been experiencing. I did that. I when I was young, one of the things we had to do was to look after sheep and goats and cattle away in the fields. And one was naturally aware of some of the dangers that might come to the animals, like, well, not wolves, but these other animals that look like wolves. And lions also would pass by and threaten cattle. So when it talks about Jesus shepherding and looking after the sheep, calling them by name, this is very familiar. So again, that's why I said, well, these things are the presence of Jesus is somehow there, but not the name. You see? And that's also why, by the way, Africans, not just Akamba, Africans, the most characteristic aspect of African Christianity is Christological love of Jesus. Africans have, in a way, I've said it somewhere in my writings, have fallen in love with Jesus. Jesus has really hit something in African spirit, in African soul. Now, there are many, many ways of speaking about Jesus. Christological terms, as we might want to say academically. I have a collection of more than 200 of such terms by which people talk about Jesus. You know? Some even say, oh, Jesus is my elephant. He goes through the woods, you know, problems. He goes through the woods and I can follow. He clears the way. These are things which mean something for them, which mean, yes, Jesus really is my leader, my guide, my protector. And so Jesus has become is the central point of reference in African Christianity. And this, again, is an indication of how, in a sense, people within their African religious ideas feel Jesus is very close to them. That is, rang the bell, so to speak, here. I think that's the English expression. Jesus has rung the bell in the heart of Africans. And I think a lot of that has been prepared through African religion. And it is one of the reasons why Christianity is spreading so rapidly, or has been spreading so rapidly in Africa. People hate the vocabulary to talk about the Christian faith. God, I mean, that being so central, and this coming to Africans that as the message of God, the gospel, the message of God. And that was something which was not there in traditional religion. People didn't talk about what God is saying to us or anything like that. They only talked about what God was doing, giving rain, protecting people in danger, and giving children to their parents and so on. So now people have incorporated these traditional ideas into focusing upon Jesus as the Word of God, something which was not there in traditional religion. That expression, Word of God, is unknown in African religion. But now the gospel comes as the Word of God. Which God? The one they knew. One they knew. So they take it up. This is the Word of God, who is named in so many words in every language. The Word of Kyumbi in the Pare language, or the word Umenzi Odali in the Pondo language in South Africa, in the word Kumvom God in the Pygmy, one of the Pygmy languages of the Congo, and so on. These are then the word of this God who is named already. And so they go on, they continue with that. They accept that as the Word of God. And that's why for them, the Bible is so, so important, because there they read the Word of God. They hear the Word of God. And they love, African Christians love the Bible. That's why I view that it is so, so good if we could really give the Bible to primary schools in Okambani. And by the way, if I may just add a little personal witness, or when I was growing up and I went, my parents sent me to school, we had, and that is still the case today, we had, well, very little books, very few books to read. In any case, in Kikamba, one or two, only the first book to teach us how to read, to write. Anyway, my parents had the New Testament. And when I knew how to read, that was the book I read every time I had opportunity to do that. And that's how I came to love the New Testament, and came also naturally to love the Bible. And that's exactly the feeling among many African Christians. They love the Bible, but not many of them have the Bible, and the majority, well, formerly the majority could not read or write, but now it's the literacy rate is about 80%. So many of them, the people can read a little bit, you know, but most of them don't have the Bible. So even if they can read a little bit, they don't have the Bible. The Bible, even though the Bible is distributed by the Bible societies at a very lower price from the cost of publication, still many people cannot afford it. And that's why I feel so, that it is so good if the children could touch the Bible, see it, handle it, and read it. That distribution, the children just came to touch the Bible, which I was holding and showing to them. And to try and, you know, keenly to look and see inside the Bible and read, you know. That picture moved me very, very much. I will send you that picture. And you will be also perhaps moved to see the keenness of the children. Please. And well, I don't want to take all the time on my Bible, but it is, you know, something very much central in my life has been and still is, and my wish for it to continue to be known by younger people in who can speak Kikamba, because also, I mean, in schools, in secondary schools, they are expected to buy the Bible for schools, but that's only English Bible. And children who have learned English for 8 years can hardly understand what the Bible is. And then it is King James version of the Bible, which is even worse than the English they know, the simple English they know. Anyway, that's only incidental to say that.
Thank you, Dr. Mbiti, for that enlightening response. Dr. Mbiti, one of the things about African religions or African Christianity that can be very confusing to a Western person like myself is the African viewpoint on the spirit world and ancestors. Would you be able to help me understand what is the place or the role of ancestors and the spirit world in African religions generally, and then in African Christianity specifically?
Well, we start with the word spirits. Now, this is an area of belief, one of the beliefs in African religion. We have already talked about God quite a bit. That's the central belief in African religion. Other beliefs include the belief of life continuing after death, beyond death. People experience them or think of them, and some have visions of spirits. But other spirits are also mentioned in connection with just imagination. People have a fiction, put it that way, fiction which features spirits. Just like in fiction, written in fiction, you feature particular characters and so on, but since they did not have written communication, it was all oral communication. And spirits would be featured very much in, or the word for spirits would be featured very much in stories. Fictitious, but in stories. And also another way of using that term is by talking about spirits, you are also talking about society, about community, and you don't want to name individuals. Technically, spirits are the remainder of persons who have died, or the ongoing of life after death. That's one of the main features of African religion, that death is not the end of the person, but that life goes on. And informal spirits. Now, these spirits are not just of ancestors, so to speak, parents and grandparents. No, they are spirits of everyone who has died, persons who have died. And that's why, to come to the word ancestor, I do not use that word, because it's very limiting. It's limiting because people talk about the departed, whether they were brothers or neighbors or old people, grandfathers, and so on. They talk about that, and not just ancestors. Now, I've coined, in order to make this expression a bit more clear, I have coined the term the living dead. The living dead, living and then dash, the living dead, instead of ancestors. Now, but the living dead are a particular part of the spirits. There are spirits of the unknown dead, and those are not part of the family. They are sometimes, if they possess people, then people feel they are sick. You know, they feel troubled by spirits of completely unknown, and those are not living dead. The living dead are those who have died in the last 2 to 5 generations back. They would still be known by names, because some of the people who are living may still know those persons who died a long back ago. So they are living in the memories of those who are alive, and also according to the beliefs that people, that death does not finish the person. Now, people have relations with the living dead, because if they appear, people will know them by name. And therefore, they are known by name within the family. And that's why people have respect to the dead grandfathers or dead grandmothers, dead grand uncles, and so on and so forth. The older you become, the more respect you should earn, you should earn in the community. So this kind of talk about ancestor, in sometime they were called ancestor worship, that's rubbish, because it is simply showing, yes, this is my grandfather whom I knew, now he has appeared, yes, and you have to show respect. Or even if he has not appeared, remembering them is very important. And that's why they may pour out a bit of beer or milk or water on the ground and say, oh, you, my grandfather, so-and-so, take also, share with this. It's a fellowship, kind of fellowship. Share with the food we are eating, you see. Because you don't let the old man, even if they are very old, you don't let them die. The children are the ones who look after them, who take care of them when they are old. So you that continues symbolically. People know that when they put a little bit of grain on the floor and say, so take your share. They know that they are not there in a physical way. It is purely symbolic. And when they see like flies come to eat there, they feel happy. Yeah, the food is being eaten by, the food for our ancestors is being eaten. They feel happy. So this is the whole picture about talk about ancestors and about spirits. Now, spirits, now here we get into some very complicated area of African religion and African life, namely the question of health, sicknesses, accidents, and finally death itself. Now, naturally, people have occupied themselves with combating sickness, with making sure people are healthy. I mean, like everywhere in the world, health is very important. Now, one of the beliefs in connection with sickness is that every kind of sickness, and that means ultimately death, is caused, is generated by a being. Normally, the being would be within the community. And that's where witchcraft and witches come into the picture. They are the ones who initially will be blamed for the sickness of the child, or the sickness of an old person, or the sickness, even the sickness of cattle, or poor production in the fields. People ask, who has caused it? Who? Not what? I mean, yes, what, naturally, what? You can say, yes, the person fell down and hurt himself and so on. Okay. But who caused that person to fall down? Who caused my child to be bitten by a mosquito and get malaria? Because you may explain, Western medicine will explain that, yes, it's malaria caused by a mosquito bite. And then the persons will say, why in a school dormitory, where there are perhaps sleeping in one dormitory, there may be 10, 15 children. Why is it that my child got bitten by the mosquito and got sick? Why not all the others? And that's where then people will say, this was caused by so and so. So-and-so sent the mosquito to bite my child. Why? Oh, because we are having a bit of quarrel with one another. Or because the parents feel jealous that my child is so bright, always comes to number in examinations, number 1, 2, 3. Whereas the child of this other woman may be the last on the list, number 25. And the parents of the 25 child point will feel jealous. So it goes the argument. Will feel jealous, and therefore they will send a mosquito to bite the child who is always number one, number two in class. Now, this is very simple explanation, but that's how often the mentality goes. And the mentality in communities is so inbuilt, even of, I'm sorry to say, even of people educated in universities and so on. Even among pastors and among deep Christians and, educated, this still comes into play. That is something an outsider, outsider to mean anyone who is not born within that community, speaks that the language of that community, shares in the worldview of that community. Anyone who is not from within the total of that community will not grasp, will not even know, you see? And that's why, for example, in the colonial days, witchcraft was made punishable. Accusations of witchcraft were made punishable by the government. But of course, the people had their own ways of punishing the witches. And they made that one of the laws against witchcraft. But that doesn't remove this idea. Okay, may I mention that some of the politicians we have today in every African country, I would say, consult the traditional medicine persons, the traditional treatment of misfortune, treatment of accidents, treatment of sicknesses, and also those treatments included giving something to bring good fortune. Now, some of the politicians are said, and I've known some of these politicians, are said to go to the traditional healer, the medicine persons, to get things, to get, what is the English word, to get...
an astrological prediction?
Yes, to get that kind of prediction.
Okay,
but not astrological the way it is done in the mm-hmm. West, but they have their method of predicting and giving you something which you can take in order for the prediction to come true. You see?
Mm-hmm.
And so they go there, especially at night, and they carry with them, even in houses of parliament, they carry with them some of these objects, you see? They hide them. And so because of this whole mentality about the spiritual world, that it's very present, and that in some ways, through the spiritual world, you can do harm or good, you see? Harm for the people who are then accused of being witches or accused of using witchcraft. But some of those who accuse them of witchcraft are also, at the same time, people who will go secretly and get charms. Yeah, that's the word I wanted. Get charms. Either to carry on their body, or they are cut a bit on the skin, and where the blood comes out, the doctor, the traditional doctor, wraps the charm there. You see? Well, I've done a lot of this investigation of treatment, and I've attended the sessions of these people giving treatment to those who go to them and so on. And so anyway, this is going on all the time among most educated and least educated in according to our traditional Western education. It is so deep in our thinking, our African worldview, mentality, and action. As I said, an outsider will not grasp the depth and impact of this area of African life. And that is in the area where very much the idea of spirits come in, because those who give that kind of treatment, that traditional doctors, may also use spirits to bring either problems or fortune.
Okay.
So they go and get this kind of, well, treatment, with some of which may involve spirits, but mainly the charms are things that are concrete. I've seen many charms, and even like if you look at my book, where is it? I have a picture somewhere. I can't quite remember on what page, where okay. Look, for example, page 154. You will see a medicine person there, and you see him wearing these horns. Now, these are animal horns where he puts some powders, the charm, some medicines. In this case, if he would use that for treating people, medical treatment, but other horns, both small and big, may be given to a person to take and keep, you see, to bring good luck. And some of these, both some educated and some non-educated politicians, some keep such things with them. University people keep such things with them. Hmm. One of the things I experienced in doing my practical research was I went to one of these medical doctors, traditional doctors, to observe and study how he was doing his work. And I was with another friend. When we started to go back to the university, a young person when we went to the car, a young person came to the car and asked for a ride. And where are you going? We asked. Oh, I'm going back to the university. That was sometime before the examinations. And you can imagine what he wanted from this traditional doctor. You see, the spirits of the known members of the family, those are not harmful. They are welcome members of the family if they appear. It is the spirits of the unknown who are feared. However, let me just add one more word about that. Spirits as sometimes the personification of physical objects or personification of an animal, personification of an happening, personification, like personification of the wind, which may blow dust and sort of harm people, they would then say it's the spirit, you know? Again, here we are coming very close to some of the ideas in the Old Testament, you know, where some things were taken in a personal way rather than today in a scientific way. Well, but again, these are interesting areas of reflection which we cannot cover in just one conversation. I tell you, but for me, they are fascinating.
Dr. Mbiti, we're very grateful for these reflections. Thank you for sharing your research and your experience with us.
Welcome, welcome.
Professor Mbiti, if I can close with this final question, I'd like to note that you served as the former director of the World Council of Churches Ecumenical Institute in Switzerland. Would you be willing to address the question, what would it mean for the church today to be united? How would we recognize this unity across the world, the Christian world, and what can we do to pursue this unity?
I see unity in both invisible reality and possible visible reality, because a church is both physical and invisible, the body of Christ, the fellowship of all the members of the body of Christ since the beginning. So that is the one area where the unity would be very important. And the other area is naturally in the area of the physical presence of the church. And there we have then to think of the meanings of the church, the word church. It has several meanings. And at some of the meanings, you can have unity. At some of the meanings of church, then you just have living together like individuals who may live together in fellowship and harmony. So the physical side would involve like constitutions of the different churches. That is where church constitutional sense is absolutely tied in. And that's where problems arise when discussions are being carried out, for example, between the Catholic Church, and the Lutheran Church or the Anglican Church, because they are now talking more on the constitutional level. And that's very, for me, is very difficult, because it involves legal aspects of that constitution. And there are legal aspects of church law and traditions, theologies which are frozen, theological views which are frozen within particular individual institutional churches. That is very difficult. There I find it's very difficult. However, by studying together, like what happens at the Ecumenical Institute in Geneva and Bose, also at many ecumenical institutes all over the world. But since you started with Bose, what happens there? It's in a very, very small way, is to live together from different denominations of the world, work together, study together, worship together, discuss theological issues together, read the Bible, the same Bible, together, and try to bring kind of understanding. Maybe each side may simply explain their identity and let the other side know the identity of this member of the church A or church B. And the other one will do the same. Then, like that, people begin to understand each other. But then that is only the students who come there. It's not the institutions. Some are sent by institutions, church institutions, but it's wonderful. Worship together is also another way of opening up these blocks of institutional churches. And one can there at Bose in Geneva, one experiences the pains of division when it comes to worship. Like Orthodox people, when the celebration of Holy Communion was being done by Orthodox priest, no other person of other churches was allowed to take the elements, bread or wine. Absolutely closed. Now that's very painful. Very, very painful. And so people really try to ask ourselves or themselves, how can we overcome this barrier which has been institutionalized? Now, I'm glad to say that at least while I was there, a bit of progress was being made. The Orthodox didn't let anybody have any elements, but we had also a Catholic professor there, priest, and when he celebrated the Eucharist, he said, I cannot invite you to come and take share, but if you come, I will not I will not stop. I will not refuse to give you the elements. You know, that was a very, very technical but beautiful way of trying to overcome this thing. Now, I know places where Catholics celebrate and invite people of all denominations who are baptized to take communion. And that's also what I have been doing in my own ministry, in my Christian ministry as pastor. When I celebrated, I said it's the Lord's table. It's not John Mbiti's table. It's not Anglican table. It's the Lord's table. And we celebrate the Lord's Supper. So it's all for all those who are members of the Lord's body. Again, and at first this was being criticized, but now I don't see anybody who fears about that. And I can also give you a tiny little bit of this attempt to break down the institutional barrier. When I started to work in the parish here in Burgdorf, it was Reformed Church, which you may call Protestant Church. And I'm an Anglican Episcopal priest. So when I took the service, I lit a candle. I lit two candles at the altar. Now, some people grumbled that I'm introducing Roman Catholicism into the Reformed Church, this kind of, but I was not forbidden. But today, there is always a candle burning in our church. They started to have it at Easter. Then all the services during Easter period had a candle, Easter candle, which was supplied by the Catholic Church, which produces church candles, and which gave the Reformed Church a present of a Easter candle, big Easter candle. Now, that kind of barrier is already finished, gone. People are coming together in fellowship. Well, this is where then studying together is very, very useful. And very, it opens up misunderstandings. It opens up positive aspects of our different traditions. And it opens up also sharing our traditions. Now, it's very slow because there are some conservatives in every church institution, in every church, and some of them are not willing to give away or to give up some of their beliefs or some of their doctrines, especially the written things. Those are very difficult. The written traditions, which have been made into church laws. Oh, that's very, very difficult. And I can see how some priests, like in the Catholic Church, really struggle with that. You know, Every pope struggles with these issues. Now the Episcopal Anglican Church is more or less, well, fortunately not institutionally split, but in practice it's kind of split over the whole question of gay priests, and some complain about women being ordained, others complain about women being pastors in Protestant churches, and so on and so on. Well, these are issues which naturally we cannot just ignore, but listen to them and try patiently to see how we can overcome them. They are living issues, and for people, individuals who are Christians and feel very deeply about them. And so we should not bulldoze them. And by the way, one of the Christological names of Jesus is bulldozer. And I read one area where the Christian used Jesus and called him bulldozer. This was a legal case where somebody had a case before the lawyers, before the court, and this man prayed that Jesus would bulldoze the opposition, the legal opposition, so that he can win, so that this person who prayed can win. Jesus, my Jesus, bulldoze the way so that I can win my case. Well, anyway, some of these barriers are very difficult. And they might need a bulldozer to remove them.
This is marvelous, Professor Mbiti. Thank you so much for your reflections. It's been our delight today to be speaking with Professor John Mbiti, Emeritus Professor of Theology at the University of Bern, and also author of Introduction to African Religions, a book which is now in its second edition. Thank you so much, Professor Mbiti, for being with us today.
You're welcome. I feel very honored to have had this interview with you. Thank you very much, Jonathan.
Thank you,
Dr. Armstrong.